22.
8 o'clock, I will call to order the February 8th meeting of Narberth Borough Council. Mr. Metrick, could you call the roll, please?
Mr. Muterich?
Present.
Mrs. Tevlin Moffett?
Present.
Mr. Diaz?
I believe we will be arriving a little bit later.
Ms. Richmond? Mr. Cilio?
He was in the room recently, but the woman is absent.
Mr. Wainwright?
Here.
Mr. Weisbord?
I believe he's also coming in.
Mayor Grady?
Present.
John Mullen?
Present. Mr. Weisbord and Mr. Cilio have entered the room. We have a new agenda in front of us prepared by the new staff in the Borough Office. And we're going to probably try a number of different styles over the course of this year as we attempt to find the most efficient way for us to meet in both our caucus and our business meetings on a monthly basis. This room is pretty well packed, and I appreciate everybody making room. I would like to do this meeting in this room. If a lot more people show up, we will take a recess and move to the bigger room. But hopefully, we can complete our business this evening this way. The fourth item on the agenda, adoption of the minutes. Would somebody like to make a motion either altogether or individually as they desire?
Move to adopt the minutes of the December 9th caucus meeting, the December 14th business meeting, the December 30th recessed session, the January 4th reorganization meeting, January 6th caucus meeting, January 11th business meeting, and the January 11th separate public hearing on ordinance 984.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Is there any discussion regarding these minutes?
Want to make sure how we're circling. Really, it's not 7 minutes, but 20. Suggested some corrections, I don't think I should circle it. Don't recall probably December 14th. Remember, I sent that one certain minutes.
Did you send them to Matt West?
Sent them to you because it was thrown up here. A lot of typos, I applied to the ability to build it.
I think those were the November minutes that we had typed.
That is my memory as well.
These are, as I said, SharePoint.
Yes.
All right, no further discussion. Is there a, ayes, favor of approving the minutes?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, unanimous. We're going to add 4.1 to the agenda, which is to take a moment to recognize that every fall, the Narberth Business Association holds an Oktoberfest to raise money for the Narberth Fire Department and the Narberth Dickens Festival. And if Mr. Ridgway and Mr. Henderson could come up, we have some nice news, which is that even though this year's event was put on hold for a week because of Hurricane Joaquin, the rescheduled event on October 10th still drew close to 400 guests to the festival tents that were put together in Narberth Park. And tonight, Mr. Ridgway from the Business Association is here to present a check for $2,500 to Bill Henderson, well, not to Bill Henderson, but to the Narberth tank. To the Narberth Fire Department. Thank you. Thank you to everyone who helped make the event.
I'm sure we have a friend who came in the camera.
He waved, and there we go. Thank you. So that is great, and looking forward to the next Oktoberfest. Long ways away. Mr. Mayor, do you have a report?
Council, I have no report, but I do have a supplement to the record that I put on last at the caucus session, so I'd like to address it at this point. Just so council's aware, I entered as M1 my veto on record with regard to ordinance 984. I do not feel it's in the best interest of the borough for council to approve that ordinance. I set forth my reasons as M2. I'm not going to repeat my reasons. They're in format form. If anyone wants a copy of it, I'd be more than glad to provide it to you. Again, I set forth the reasons that I don't believe that this ordinance 984 serves our interests. Our interests are for our town. Now, with regard to number three, I raised it briefly in my memorandum with regard to ordinance 984, and I had a wonderful conversation with a dear friend, Christina Valerius. Christina Valerius lives on Woodbine Avenue. I've known her for 25 years. She lives adjacent to the Lutheran Church. I asked Christina, what did you think of ordinance 984? And her response to me was, what is ordinance 984? I said, well, the ordinance 984 affects several of the church properties in the area, and even the Lutheran Church, although, albeit it's an active church, it still falls under that ordinance. Christina advised me that she was somewhat upset that no one ever put a flyer in her door, no one ever reached out to her with regard to ordinance 984, and she didn't have the time really to tell me whether she supported or didn't support it. But there's a fatal flaw with regard to 984. There's properties in North Narberth where residents live adjoining to have no idea what this ordinance says. And had the ordinance been drafted properly, it would have listed the Lutheran Church, it would have listed the Presbyterian Church. People would have been put on notice with regard to this ordinance, and it hasn't. So albeit all my discussions with regard to how I feel about ordinance 984, a critical point, albeit aside, is not many people know about 984. They're going to be directly affected by it. And I think that's a fatal flaw to any enactment of that ordinance by this council. And I want to put that on the record with regard to that. The last item with regard to I have, and I mark as M3, there was a letter sent around. It went through wildfire, through town, with regard to reasons for 984. And one of the contents of the letter was sent from Councilman Gigi Moffitt, it was sent to Marley Richmond, it was sent to Councilman Richard Diaz. I'm not going to get into great detail over it, but I do want to address two points with regard to that letter. One is my veto is mandated and permitted by Borough Council law. It's nothing unusual. I have no intentions of taking over the town. I'm not unstoppable. I am stoppable. And one of the wonderful things that we have in our borough code is we have a check and balance. Mayor doesn't like it. Council doesn't like it. Council has a right to override me if they have sufficient votes for that. It's a really wonderful document. It keeps us in check. We're not on the same team. We're not the same people. We have all come with different ideas to council. I think you'd be disappointed if we all did have different ideas. Sometimes the best ideas win, and I may very well be what happens here. And third part, we all know that we owe responsibility to our people in town. I do not sit here but for the fact that I was elected to office 14 years ago. And I thank the council, and I thank the people of our town for electing me. It's a privilege, it's an honor. If you don't want me, you vote me out. If you want me, you vote me in. It's as simple as that. And you know that responsibility to listen to the people of our town. With that, I'm finished, and that's the end of my report.
Thank you, John. So part of our experiment with a new agenda is at this meeting, which is our business meeting, moving public comment up to be at a much earlier period so that everyone doesn't have to sit here while we formally kind of rehash committee reports and things like that. And so I will begin public comment. Many of you have already spoken regarding issues in the borough, specifically Ordinance 984, which I am expecting many of you are here tonight to hear about and discuss. In the interest of time, I would encourage you to add new information to the counselors who are here, if you have it. If you would just like to say that you are in favor or opposed, that will suffice. If you would like to say that someone else summarizes your comments, that's fine. And we'll get through this evening expeditiously. I will impose a 3-minute time limit on each speaker. And I will start in the front right. Dan, moving down to the left. If you do like to speak, if you could just state your name and address clearly for the court reporter. And then go ahead with your comments.
I'm Lisa Bottoms, 201 Marion Avenue. I have a question regarding does council have money set aside for the playground equipment, for the maintenance and repair of the playground equipment? I was down there with my grandson many times since the summer, and I've noticed that this equipment, a lot of it's damaged. Even if it could just use a great power wash, maybe some new sand, maybe just some sort of maintenance to sort of brighten it up. That's my question. Are there money set aside for...
And so normally, just for the crowd, public comment is generally you make a comment and we listen. But I think this is something that we could get you an answer. Mr. Diaz, in property maybe, or...
Specifically, is it on the agenda item with money set aside? I'd have to defer to finance on how much we would have.
They're not specifically for the, like, just the playground. There's a building fund.
Okay.
That goes to property repair, including the playground. And the playground, along with the tennis court resurfacing, and the parks and recreation improvements are on the agenda for the next property meeting.
Yeah, so still the back end of my thunder. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Which we will meet every third Thursday at 8 p.m.
Okay.
But yes, so there is money set aside for it.
There are also additional funds that are raised by the 4th of July Committee, and the Borough Government works with the 4th of July Committee to identify needs such as replacing whole pieces of equipment and things like that to fund that through the money that's generated through the 4th of July activities.
So it's my suggestion that you might take a look at that.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have nothing to add except from those to my...
And could you just state your name and address?
Chris Calvert, 161 Marion Avenue.
Thank you.
I'll say Paul Calvert.
Paul Calvert.
161 Marion Avenue.
Thank you. Down to the left. Anyone who's down on the floor, sitting comfortably?
Hi, I'm John Millard, 214 Marion Avenue, and I'm opposed to the ordinance.
Okay. Anyone else on the floor? Go ahead.
Robin Bernholz, 212 Marion Avenue. I sent a letter, so I don't know if it's redundant.
We'll get the letters, so I will. Okay. Ms. Longstore?
Deborah Longstore, 128 Chestnut Avenue. I have sent a couple of letters, and I just want to reiterate that I agree with the mayor, and I am completely opposed to the amendment.
Thank you. And I'll go down all the standing room. Okay. Let's start second row on the right. So, go ahead, Terry Fox.
We're David and Terry Fox at 104 Maple Avenue, and we sent a letter in at about 5:30, and we requested that you submit it to the meetings, and we are in support of Mayor Grady's veto.
Okay. Ms. Nardi?
I'll pass.
Go ahead.
Georgette Dubois, 111 Price Avenue, and I have a question about the format of what we're doing. So will there be an opportunity for the public to comment or ask questions after things are discussed? Because a lot of people here won't even...
I think most of the discussion was at our caucus meeting.
Right, but there are people here who weren't there.
Right, but at this meeting, our format will be to hear public comment, and then we will have any motions that councilors would like to put on the table. There would be a discussion amongst the councilors, and then the councilors would be able to vote. But there wouldn't be a further public comment once those individual motions go on the table.
Okay, that's what I wanted to understand. So anyone who wants to speak about anything needs to speak now. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so then I have a question.
Yeah. I will just add that after the agenda items are complete, we will have an opportunity if you had something further to add.
There will be.
But that may be after.
Gotcha, okay. All right, well, I will take the opportunity now. I had asked about the leases the last time. I had been sent the leases that were not signed, and I understand that those could have been earlier leases. And so someone asked a question about the leases today on Facebook, and I sent all the links, but he couldn't open the links. So my request is that the links to the signed leases be posted on the website so that everybody, they're supposed to be public now. We've waited for many, 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 many months to be able to see the leases. So can those links be posted in a way that all of the public can access them? And this is for the 201 Sabine property, the old Narberth school, and there are five entities that rent space there or have leases pending or whatever. And then I have a specific question about the food bank, and is the food bank lease signed, and has the food bank started paying rent?
First, Mr. Metrick, could you speak to the leases going on the website or being...
Sure.
how they can be available to the public.
Yeah, we can do that.
Good.
Timeline?
As soon as you send an email, and then it gets posted, usually within 48 hours.
The Borough sends an email to the website.
Got it.
That will change.
Gotcha.
And in regards to your question about the food bank, are you able to answer that, Mr. Metro?
It is signed.
And has rent been paid?
Yes.
Okay, can you tell us the amount of the rent? Because I know the lease reads that the lease is effective as of July 1st in one place, and in another place it says it's effective as of August 1st. So what months or months have been paid for it thus far, and what at what amount?
I'm going to have to look at reports of the property to answer that question. So
maybe
can't
property
answer that question
can answer.
Right.
I think we're gonna, I don't know, do you have that information?
No.
I don't think we have it here.
So we know that something has been paid, we don't know the amount, and we don't know what time or what period of time.
We do not have that information at the meeting. I guarantee you that information is in the office.
It would be sometime after it was officially made ready for occupancy, which followed the elevator installation.
Sometime after.
Have, yeah, but we've used up a lot of time. Do you have anything else on your, okay.
Thank you.
Rosemary McDonough, 9 Elmwood Avenue, and I support Mayor Grady's veto.
Thank you.
Susan Snow, 423 Grove Place, I support Mayor Grady's veto.
Thank you.
I'm Jim Cornwell, 115 Wendell Road in Narberth. I'm also the chair of the Planning Commission, and I'd just like to make a couple of remarks about the course that this thing has taken of late. We've been working on this project. First became aware of this developer in April of last year and have striven to make a deal happen that would save that building, which is the vowed intention of Planning Commission. With all these buildings, it's about preserving these landmark structures in our town that give it part of its character. We want to do it in a way that is that minimizes the ill effects on neighbors in all locations, and I would address to speak to Tom about that includes the other churches, which are hale and hearty at the present time and are not likely candidates for this kind of treatment in my lifetime, as I see, which hopefully is long. God knows. The other buildings are better suited than the Baptist Church for underground parking, which was the strategy employed at the Methodist Church at the brow of the hill in Essex and at the Gleason Center on Forest Avenue, where we were able to solve the parking problem, at least the local parking problem, by sticking the cars in the basements of what had been the basements of those two buildings. That's not technically feasible with the Baptist Church, and that therein is the big devil that has bedeviled this project. So we've spent a lot of time talking about the cards and what's going to happen with the cards. There ain't no good answer to this. The only answer is on surface. So looking at the church, other churches that the mayor just enumerated, I don't see that as a problem. I would call to the attention of the council the alternative. Everyone's against Ordinance 984. What are you for? So I'm for not having four townhouses on that site. Part of the problem with having four townhouses on that site is there will be curb cuts for each of the four, proposed anyway, and I don't think we'll be able to permit that at that dangerous intersection. Lastly, so you're gonna have a parking problem no matter what happens. With in closing, I'd like to suggest that in the 11th hour, there have been some negotiations between the developer. It is my understanding from the buzz that I get that there have been some negotiations which have gotten us very close, as I understand it, to the conditions that the mayor was attempting to negotiate with this developer. And I would encourage the council to be flexible about dropping the hammer on this project when a week or two of continued negotiations between well-meaning people could easily solve this problem and enable us all to win. Okay, I just leave you with that.
Thank you. Mr. Gordon, and then I'll start. Jason Gordon, 198 Elmwood. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. In May 2015, my company purchased the old Baptist Church on Elmwood Avenue. Our goal was to renovate the building and move our office to Narberth. We were told by the borough manager at the time that this project was consistent with the borough's plans as it was next to the train station, across from an apartment building, and within 100 yards of Narberth's commercial district. We were excited to start the process last June. My expectation was that we would become part of this great community. We would patronize the restaurants, visit the shops, and blend in seamlessly. In fact, one of my employees is a Narberth resident, and she will walk to work. We chose this location because it would be a perfect, adaptive reuse of a great building and a wonderful office space for our employees. As a business owner, it is important to me that my employees not only enjoy the office space where they work, but also enjoy the community in which our business lives. Having a commercial district under a minute from the office was very important to our decision, and we believe that this would be mutually beneficial to our employees and to the business community of Narberth. I personally fell in love with the building, its unique details, stone exterior, beautiful woodworking, and the opportunity to save and restore this piece of history. We came into this process open-minded and willing to compromise to save the building. After council passed Ordinance 984, I learned that the ordinance was at risk of being vetoed. I requested a meeting with the mayor to address my continued willingness to work with him and borough council to come to an agreeable compromise, and he agreed. In fact, we met 3 times over 4 days. During the first meeting, the mayor asked me to agree to 5 conditions to be memorialized by the solicitor in a binding agreement. Mayor Grady said that if we agreed to these conditions, he would not veto the ordinance. The mayor and I disagree about the specifics of the conditions he proposed. However, tonight I will share with council that I have always been and still am willing to find a reasonable solution that allows this project to move forward, saves this building, and satisfies the concerns of the residents of Narberth. We are prepared to agree to the following. No backlit signs or neon signs on the property. An 11-car parking lot with landscaping plan that is agreed upon with the Planning Commission during the conditional use process. We will work with the Planning Commission and the Lower Merion Conservancy to preserve the historic exterior of the building and use building materials that are consistent with its original character. Our office hours will be from 7 a.m. until 6 p.m. with an exemption for 25% of total employees who may work either early or late. We will agree to a cap on employees. Lastly, we will agree to a fair and reasonable disbursement of cars that would use street parking so as not to burden the surrounding area. We remain committed to saving this building and are prepared to work with council to find a mutually agreeable solution.
Eric Santo, 121 Elmwood Avenue. And I just want to say I agree with Mayor Grady's veto.
Dan Yodi, 220 North Narberth Avenue. I just wanted to say I'm hoping we can find a way to help this gentleman who is going to spend a lot of money. I've done renovations, and it's so much easier to do a teardown. But why we all love Narberth is this historical relevance of this town. And I'm hoping that we could find a way to compromise where we're able to save a significant building of historical value and someone who is willing to work with the neighbors to protect their interests. But that building has been abandoned for years. I've only been here 23 years, but I don't know if it's ever been occupied in that time.
It has?
Yes.
Well, it hasn't been for a long time, and I would love to see someone put money into it to save it and help this community be business and residential friendly.
Frank Ranalicio, 314 North Essex Avenue.
currently based on the mayor's reasoning. I also oppose the variance 984 and support his veto. Glad to hear there may be some other stuff going on that could be beneficial. There was a lot of meeting minutes that were approved. I did read the November 9th meeting minutes when I first came to the council regarding the Holtman Garage issue. And I appreciate Sean did a very nice and fair job of capturing the meeting minutes. I also had presented a public letter to be included for the December 14th minutes, which I understand have just been approved. And I was hoping that, I guess there's other letters that also get submitted in, that now electronically maybe some of those would be embedded in the meeting minutes such that they are electronically available.
Hoping that all of the standard reports, letters on the table, and minutes would be a packet for each meeting.
Okay, great. That would be, I think, beneficial to the public that could go in and look for themselves. A project which gets approved currently the way the code is written that we are under now, that if a project does not require variance, it does not require you to that be shared with the neighbors. Just something to consider when there are large projects, that maybe that's something we consider and notify neighbors that such a large project, any project, is going on in that neighborhood, so neighbors are aware.
And I think as a result of your recent concerns regarding the garage that was built on the Holtman property, the borough office does plan to more widely distribute notification to neighbors when there are demolition applications.
Okay, great.
Regardless of any laws on the books, that's going to be our standard operating procedure.
Great. I appreciate hearing that. Also, I hope that the builders, I know that we did have the Methodist Church. It was changed to residential, which I was happy about, the strictly residential and the parking. But I hope that the builders that do work there do respect the neighborhood and the neighbors. I mean, we had contractors using our porch. We had the dumpster that sat out on the street taking a parking spot for over 2 years where we had limited parking, where they have a driveway and everything. So I would hope that any builders that work in our neighborhood really respect the neighbors that are there and are not just coming in, doing what they need to do, and parking, you know, bus. Essex has a bus that runs through there, and it was double parking for years and stuff. So, and that's basically it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Go
ahead. I'm Catherine Kurtz. I live at 531 Dudley Avenue. I looked at the video from the caucus meeting, and I heard some discussion about whether or not the borough council might find a way to consider meeting New Horizons at their price point. And I'd like to ask a few questions about your willingness to reconsider that. I understand it's complicated, but I have a couple of questions. First of all, would anyone on council, or maybe two or three of you, be willing to go to New Horizons and meet with some of the citizens there and find out what they find so valuable about the place? The second thing is, would you reconsider really looking at that if, for example, the AARP living aging in place guidelines, or the Montgomery County guidelines on aging, or the state guidelines on aging, recommend an active senior center in a town in order for it to be livable? Finally, I guess I'm wondering, would you be willing to really relook at this again, even if it costs the borough some money, if a sizable number of residents, hundreds or maybe 1,000, signed a petition saying, this is something really important to us and we would like you to expend some resources on keeping a senior center active here in Narberth. I am 74 years old and hope to age in place, and can well imagine that I would really like to be able to walk to a place and have lunch every day, or learn to play bridge, God forbid, or join a book discussion or get some exercise. So I'd really encourage you to do that and would like to hear if you're willing to reconsider or do any of those things.
Thank you. I think that those are all good questions. Probably best addressed to individual counselors rather than in this format. And so I encourage you to stick around to the end of the meeting because we all kind of hang around, and I would be happy to speak with you. I know others would as well.
Do you think people would be willing to go and meet the seniors there and really hear about them?
I have been there, so I could say yes, and I'm sure others would, but I think after the meeting would be the best time to discuss it in more detail.
Okay.
I'm going to go Jim Spear, and then I'm going to loop around.
Jim Spear, 321 Grayling. I want to say I'm in favor of 984. I'm on planning commission that worked on 984. I just want to say briefly that this is not an ordinance that directly approves Mr. Gordon's project. It's an ordinance that allows him to apply for his project. So unless we pass 984, we'll never even get to consider the pros and cons of Mr. Gordon's project. And he'll never even get to submit it, and we'll never get to comment on it and ask for changes and ask for considerations. I think 94 is something that's going to be beneficial throughout the borough. It's going to be beneficial when the Lutheran Church ever needs to be redeveloped in any way, be maximum flexibility in that process. That would also go to a conditional use hearing. Each property would go to a specific conditional use hearing, and each property would be considered individually. But 984 does not address any one particular property in particular. And that's why I'm in favor of it. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Oh, Cuddier Cannon, 128 Woodside Avenue. I support the mayor's veto.
Thank you. Mr. Ridgeway?
No, thank you.
I just want to say I support the ordinance. Oh, sorry. Katie Skeen, 227 Hampton Avenue. I do support the ordinance, at least so we can get to that stage where we can hear the plan. And I was a part of the past few years of kind of community input on the form-based zoning. And there was so much discussion and so much kind of positive thinking in that planning that centered around, like, what do we love about Narberth, and what makes the streetscape vibrant, what makes this town work. And I really feel like what I know of the proposed plan kind of fits into that. I think it's a good plan.
Thank you.
Cindy Rothman, 32 Narberth Park. I must say, as much as I like to consider myself an active resident in Narberth, I'm a little confused by what this is all about. I would highly recommend waiting 2 weeks, seeing what discussions can happen with the developer. I think that people are starting to process perhaps what it is all about. I think we all take it personally. We all love Narberth. I don't see any disadvantage to giving this vote another 2 weeks.
Thank you. Go ahead, we'll move around the back row.
Amy Tikowski Feldman, I'm at 208 Forest Avenue, and I support the ordinance. I live across the street from one of the properties that's been developed under the conditional use. And the time and work and care that members of our community who are on the commission have put into making sure that things were done carefully and beautifully and in keeping with the needs of the neighborhood have been very impressive. And I'd like to see the opportunity for that process to continue in this other development.
Did you want to speak to your letter to council?
I would love to speak to my letter to council.
Have 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Okay.
Do I have 2 minutes worth? Can I hand council some material to look at while we, or I'll just pass it up. How about that? Why don't you pass these up?
I think some of them have received.
Some of them have received. So if you have them, you can give them to people in the audience. So my name's Amy. I'm your neighbor. I've been working on climate issues. This is Dan Walk. I think a lot of you know him.
Yeah, I just moved out of the borough 2 years ago. I live behind the Acme, just in the suburbs of Narberth. I lived here for well, 30 years. My kids are all grown. Anyways, great to see many of you again. About in 2009, I stood before this council and presented a climate action plan for Narberth. So this had nothing to do with redevelopment, but it also has something to do with redevelopment, because how we go forward from here as the community of Narberth has an impact on the global climate and also our resiliency in the face of the extreme weather events and other things that happen and will happen with climate change. So very briefly, when I presented the climate action plan and Mayor Grady honorably and gladly signed the mayor's proclamation, participating with the 73rd Annual Conference of Mayors, spurred on by Abby Fox, to saying that Narberth would actually take action to help with action on climate change. So it's been some time has passed since then, and instead of talking about cap and trade, we are talking about price on carbon, which was endorsed by the latest conference in Paris. And we'd like Narberth to participate by endorsing congressional action to that end. So we're providing you information on pricing carbon so that the money that comes from extraction of fossil fuels goes back to every U.S. taxpayer and provides an incentive to make our economy more productive, but at the same time more efficient and lower carbon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And did, if you could just state your name and current address for the record.
Dr. Daniel Wolk, W-O-L-K, Tuchscheller Avenue, Narberth.
Thank you.
So just very, very specifically asking for the borough to consider an endorsement and any information that you need from me to decide if, as a council, you're comfortable making that endorsement, I will be happy to provide.
I will choose a committee to send this to, and it will be discussed in committee, and then the committee can decide what to do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jim Nixon. I live at 219 Williams Avenue. With respect to the recent ordinance and the mayor's veto, I've spent a great deal of time talking with some of you involved and looking at the issues. And my wife used to live on Elmwood Avenue, and I grew up in a shore town where historic preservation and parking and zoning were and are constant issues. I guess just briefly, I've been a little bit concerned and disappointed how I think it's good that everyone's turning out, and that's a very positive takeaway. I think the negative takeaway is it's been a divisive factor and perhaps not good for the political dialogue of a small town. So I guess I would just respectfully ask two things. I would ask the council to please thinking about possibly putting this off or exploring a more creative solution in which there are more winners. And I would ask the developer to please remain patient and allow council the opportunity to pursue that avenue if they choose. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jennifer Pryor, 314 Grayling Avenue, and I'm in support of the ordinance. After listening to Mr. Gordon's plan, I think that it's reasonable. I think it's in the best interest of Narberth. I think that purely residential use is not the answer, and I think that it is the answer that we need to preserve as many historic buildings as possible. I think Mr. Gordon should have his opportunity to present his plan formally, and I think it's a good idea in the best interest of Narberth. And I support the ordinance. Thank you.
Kimberly Bezak, 237 Dudley. Just want to concur with Jim Cornwell's comment as well as Jim Spear's comment and echo support for the ordinance. I would also ask that if the veto override does not occur We find ourselves facing a situation where we're on the verge of losing the church to demolition. I would encourage you to move quickly to determine if the temporary demo moratorium is permitted under Pennsylvania law to stop demolitions until a demolition review ordinance or some type of demolition review board is in place in the borough. My main priority is to just make sure that amazing structure stays standing, and I do think that Mr. Burton has demonstrated many times, including tonight, that he's willing to be surprisingly flexible and hopes that he can still create something really great here in the borough. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Marco, I think you've done something regarding that demolition board. Is that something that's committed? And I think, actually, as Kimberly brought up at a previous meeting, the idea of the historical review boards. From what I've seen, there needs to be a historical review board set up and a process that would be set up to establish what properties really serve the purpose to the benefit of the community. And quite honestly, it could be the entire community if it qualifies as such. But without that process, there is no due process for property owners, and therefore, if it was considered a taking of someone's property, that prevents them from using the property as they would like to see fit. But again, if you were to establish a historical review board, much like a zoning board, to go through the proper processes, that would be something that could start to put that in place. It does take time, it takes effort. So if that was in place, I think we'd be in a lot better position to look at some historic areas, historic properties, be able to identify why they're of value. And even then, it can't be an absolute no tear down, but at least you would be able to be in a position to have hearings, and the property owners would have to come to those hearings before that review board to talk about why they should be able to demolish their house. And if it meets that higher burden right now, which is a non-existent city. Thank you.
Pamela Sanford, 209 Woodside Ave, and I support the mayor's veto, and I would just like to emphasize that you have in the past that this ordinance does not speak directly to historical preservation one way or the other, and it's a red herring that if it does or doesn't pass, that the church will or will not stand. So that's really not the issue that people have been upset about.
Thank you.
Greg Gorton, 209 Woodside Avenue. You know, I think part of what led to the made this a flashpoint was the introduction of commercial use, office use. That was not part of what was done with the other churches that had been preserved. And it's an introduction of that form of use in a part of the borough that has not had that, has never had that. That's a critical element in this whole discussion. It still remains to be unclear why he wouldn't, Jason, wouldn't have just pursued a variance. And by the way, if the mayor's veto is upheld, the developer can still go after a variance. So there are other ways to go about this that I think are being forgotten. You know, the question is, I mean, we'd all love to save the church, but at what cost and to whom? To whom in particular? Which neighbors are involved in this? I think that's part of why there's been so much concern about this.
Thank you. Mr. Herring.
Yes. Jim Herring, 118 Chestnut Avenue in Narberth. And the other conversions of the church, as has been said before, have been done for residential purposes. And being one of the canvassers of South Narberth, the issue that was of concern to everybody I talked to, and I went to every house on Chestnut Avenue that I was able to get to, was the fact of the commercial use of the church. There's no question we'd like to have the church there. There's no question that it cannot be a residential conversion. And that's my points.
Thank you. I noticed some people came in a little bit late. If there's anybody who has not had the chance to speak but would like to do so, if you could raise your hand. See, One, two, three. I see you. See you. Okay, I'll start with you, Mr. Kravinsky.
Sure. Let me see. Oh. Ken Kravinsky, One Woodside Avenue. Apologize for being late. Thank you, everyone, for your deliberations tonight on the church. Right now, I feel like I'm watching a game of chicken. Where we're waiting to see who's going to blink first, the developer or the borough. As with many games of chicken, I fear that this could end in a crash, the destruction or the demolition of the church that predates Narberth. After the last council meeting, I've been learning about the Spanish house as it predates my time in Narberth. But for many in the community, I'm sure this feels like deja vu. I hope that this time we're going to see a different outcome. We're better off playing a game of chess right now and really thinking about what is the end game. And everyone in this room probably has a different end game that they personally want. For me, I want to make sure how do we ensure the viability and the future of the church standing in town. Right now, the developer is interested in a deal that will save the church. If this ordinance does not pass, I don't know what the next moves are going to be. With today's market, there are far more lucrative options for redevelopment, whether that's through demolition, through redesign, or anything like that. The estimate I've heard for demolition of the church is under $100,000, which is relatively cheap. I fear that the next move is not one of maintaining the church. Now, for those in the room that don't particularly care about the preservation of the church, I respect your view, and encouraging council to do nothing right now makes a lot of sense. I personally am very interested in the preservation of the church, so my request of council is to do what you're already doing. Think of what the end game is right now and which decision will be most likely to preserve this piece of Narberth history. Thank you.
Thank you. Saw a hand over here on the right.
I'm Noreen Walsh at 101 Woodside Avenue. I've already sent letters to a few people on council. I am very much against the ordinance. I don't think that we need it at this point. We can see what happens with other development options. The fact that our mayor spent, from what I read in his objection, 3 days trying to get the developer to be willing to budge on where he stood, and he wouldn't do it. I mean, with our mayor, it doesn't leave me with much hope for this particular developer. And I strongly urge council not to override the veto.
Thank you. And I saw one hand in the back. Sir.
Mark McCullough, 212 Marion Avenue. I support the mayor's veto, and I do just want to say that I don't think anybody wants to see the church torn down. I keep hearing people say the church is ever, people want the church torn down. Nobody wants the church torn down, but we're not sure we want to develop the rights.
Thank you.
One more.
There
was one.
Sir.
Hank Holmes, I'm at 102 Chestnut Avenue. 35 years been here. Strongly opposed the amendment. I support the mayor and all of his efforts and the time he spent to go into this and come up with a with his version of events. And I, like Jim, walk the streets, Chestnut Avenue, Woodside, talking to neighbors. We don't want it. We don't want the cars, the parking, the congestion. We don't like the way this is being done.
Thank you. All right, I do have a few letters on the table. We deferred from reading letters at our last meeting, but I'm going to read a few of them now. If you can bear with me for a moment. Mr. Kravinsky, I believe, read his letter. I'm going to, Ms. Fox, would you like me to read this letter aloud? This is from Terry Fox, Terry and David Fox. Dear Borough Council, we urge you to uphold Mayor Grady's veto of the amendment to Ordinance 94, even in face of the latest threats of teardown. If, as he presented himself, Mr. Gordon is truly a Narb at heart and intent on being a good neighbor, he will act honorably and move forward on a quality residential conversion of the Baptist Church under the conditions of the current ordinance. This move would preserve the church, protect our residential neighborhood, and result in a substantial profit for Mr. Gordon, a win all around. If Mr. Gordon is not as he presented himself, he may choose to tear down the church. The subsequent loss of this historic property will serve as a wake-up call and hopefully inform our engagement on future projects. We cannot allow ourselves to be prey to developers who falsely present themselves and play on our fears, nor we can allow developers to embed themselves in our power structure, bypass zoning protocol, and rewrite code in order to maximize their profit, regardless of the will of the residents and the impact on our community. Ordinance 984 is working as it stands, please vote to uphold the mayor's veto. David and Terry Fox, 104 Maple Avenue. Robin Barinholtz, is there something else in your letter that I should read aloud, or should I just enter it into the record?
Robin.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, Robin.
I think you
okay, I will enter that into the record. Mr. Spear, anything additional in your letter?
No, I already spoke.
Okay, fair. Letter here from Alexandra Tyne. Tate, would you like me to read it? All right. To the members of Borough Council, I urge you to uphold Mayor Tom Brady's veto of amendment to Ordinance 94. I live on the south side of Narberth, and though I am not generally opposed to the idea of a mixed use as an alternative for repurposing of older church and civic buildings, I feel that a mixed use solution for the Elmwood Church would be inappropriate in our immediate neighborhood. That has always been totally residential since its origins in the 1890s when the church and the original housing development were built. The amendment is actually the most recent link in a chain of efforts to allow mixed use in this particular church. Several years ago, the block where the church is situated was zoned 4A, mixed residential slash business, in the proposed form-based zoning code, yet this zoning affects only the church building. To me, the argument that this block is a natural extension of downtown Narberth simply doesn't hold water since the block is across the tracks from downtown, since it has never been anything but residential, and especially since the church is the only building affected by the zoning. Coming at this from another direction, there are developers and investors who are very interested in making money by buying property in this town. I am not in favor of the destruction of significant older structures by people who don't care a whit about the beauty, character, and fiber of Narberth. I am in favor of repurposing, renovating, and restoring older buildings. Yes, I would love to see this church brought back to useful life, but I do not want to see this done via the disregard for the nature of the neighborhood through introducing dubious zoning into a historically all-residential section, and now through this amendment that is specifically designed to benefit this particular developer slash investor. I am well aware that the present owner of the church could tear it down, though he says he does not intend to do so. He is not bound by Ordinance 984. If he does not get his way, that is, if he does not have permission for mixed use, he does not have to agree to repurpose the building. This is a frightening prospect for those of us who care about the church, but the fact that this property could have been bought at a lower price by a developer who would have turned the church into condos. It is the proposed 4A zoning and now the proposed amendment that have encouraged the present owner to believe he can have his way. What an unfortunate note we, the community, have allowed ourselves to be tied into by being tempted to pave the way for developers willing to pay more for a building rather than giving more thought to what we believe is best for our future. I would very much like to see the Borough Council, the Planning Commission, and the residents work together to come up with a better solution that protects older structures and ensures the future of Narberth as a great place to live. Thank you. Moving right along. Noreen, would you like me to read this out loud, or do you feel like you? Okay. Zoning code related to the conditional use approvals for certain non-conforming uses. I will not be able to attend the caucus or council meeting and request this letter be read into the record. I am writing to urge Borough Council to override the mayor's veto. I'd like to underscore that the purpose of this proposed zoning amendment is simple: to allow a certain type of building in the borough, mostly churches, to be converted in part to office uses. These buildings can already be converted to residential uses, so this amendment would expand the types of uses that could be considered. The overall goal of this section of the zoning code is to provide Borough Council with the flexibility to preserve buildings of historic and cultural value to the entire community, buildings whose loss, Council has already agreed, would amount to irreparable change and would diminish the character and history of our town. It is important to note that this ordinance does not enable any development as of right. Every development proposal will require careful scrutiny by the Planning Commission and approval by the Borough Council and advertised public meetings. In every case, the Planning Commission can recommend and the Borough Council can impose appropriate conditions before any conversion is approved. It is also important to note that this ordinance tightens up language regarding the enforcement of the conditions, an issue that was critical to me as a Planning Commissioner. Those conditions will be recorded in legal documents to which the borough will be a party, requiring borough council approval for any future changes to the building and enabling the borough to challenge any violations. It is hard to imagine why the borough council would not want to afford itself every option possible to preserve the architectural and urban fabric of Narberth. It is hard to imagine why the borough council would not want to tighten up the enforcement of this provision of the zoning code. Moreover, the mayor's veto of this ordinance usurps the council's role in evaluating on a case-by-case basis complex development proposals. The mayor's veto usurps the council's role in setting conditions to guide these complex development processes in a manner that respects our community. Ironically, the mayor's veto may reduce the ability of the community to have input into these projects in the future. And unfortunately, the mayor's veto reduces the ability of the borough to hold developers accountable for their promises. It is not clear to me how this veto leaves Narberth in a better position to preserve its architectural heritage or to shape the form of complex development projects. Many borough residents, I'm closing it, many borough residents, particularly of South Narberth, have protested this ordinance because they are concerned about the potential for the conversion of the Elmwood Baptist Church. Whatever the merits of their concerns, those concerns should be discussed when an application for converting the church has been made and the Planning Commission and Borough Council are in a position to discuss an actual application as well as specific conditions that might be placed on the development to mitigate how those mitigate those concerns. That is the proper time to negotiate with the developer, not now. Unfortunately, only a handful of these concerned residents attended the Planning Commission meeting held on November 24th to discuss 984, compared to the dozens who attended the public hearing. On November 24th, people's concerns were heard in an open conversation, and all of the suggestions those residents made to the Planning Commission that evening were then incorporated into the Commission's recommendations to the Council. Nonetheless, and regrettably, at least one of those residents still spoke against the ordinance at the public hearing. It was a disappointment to me as a planning commissioner that the commission's good faith effort to recommend an ordinance that would balance borough-wide issues with our neighbors' concerns apparently carried little weight. It is regrettable that the mayor, who did not attend that meeting, nevertheless saw fit to veto the ordinance. Again, I urge you to take whatever steps are available to you to override the mayor's veto. Best regards, Todd Bressy, citizen of Narberth and member of the planning commission. Is this a point of information, Ms. Fox?
Yes, because Pamela and I were at that November planning commission meeting, and we made recommendations that were not included in the amended ordinance.
So noted.
We were told by the Kathleen, who is quite a conservancy, when I talked with her about it, and she said, well, we can't make it too specific. We have to keep the ordinance general, because if we make it too specific, then it'll
Thank you. All right, those are the letters on the table. Those are the comments of the public. I'll move on to the next item on the agenda, number 7, action items. We have four items which are placed on the agenda at the request of councilors, and I will accept a motion for any of them to begin this part of our meeting.
Making the motion that Jennifer Ryan vetoed, I'd like to discuss.
Well, let's have our discussion within the context of a motion. So if someone wants to make a motion, we could discuss it.
I have resolution 2016-05.
Sure.
Council members, this resolution 2016-05 is an approval to amend the 2016. Council members, this resolution 2016-06 is a motion to appoint Yerkes Associates of Westchester, Pennsylvania to the positions of the Narberth Borough Building Inspector and Plumbing Inspector.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? All in favor of approving your appointment? Sorry.
By way of discussion, since we have a large number of members of the public, could the committee maybe give very snapshot background as to
sure,
why the appointment.
Be happy to do that. Yerkes Associates have been working for the borough since the enactment of the UCC, which was the Uniform Construction Code, which was after Mr. Capiferi resigned from being our inspector. The borough council at that time appointed Yerkes Associates of Westchester to be our borough engineer. And at that time,
the borough also retained a plumbing inspector. However, it's most efficient for Yerkes to also do the plumbing inspections because they're on the site doing the inspections anyway. So that's why we're recommending that Yerkes perform both of those services, the construction inspection as well as the plumbing inspection.
Okay. Anyone else? All in favor of resolution 2016-06 appointing Yerkes to the position of Narberth Borough Building Inspector and Plumbing Inspector?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? None. Any other motions?
We're working back to front. I would like to bring up for vote, since it's been advertised, resolution 2006-005. The members of the Finance and Administration Committee of Borough Council present the following resolution for vote and approval. The approval of amended 2016 budget with the reallocation of expenditures and no change to the borough tax rate.
For a second.
I'll second.
Any discussion?
Snapshot summary for everybody. On December 30th, we passed a 2016 budget, and on January 4th, we have a new borough councilor in a seat, a new borough manager in a seat, and a new assistant borough manager in a seat. So taking advantage of a rule that the Commonwealth affords us, we opened the budget again for a second look without changing anything on the millage rate or any of the tax rates. We just said, knowing what we know and the cash and carryover from last year, are there expenditures we'd like to move from one line to another? We did about $40,000, about 1% of total expenditures, for a few minor reasons we talked about last Wednesday. So minor moves, but just to make sure we have enough headroom in a few key accounts, using some extra headroom we had in other accounts. So it's a slight reallocation of expenditures, no change to the tax rates. We have to approve it before February 15th. This is our meeting before February 15th, so it's introduced for consideration.
All in favor of approving resolution 2015-005, amended 2016 budget?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? None. Passes unanimously. Maybe someone wants to pay the bills.
Yeah, we should. Oh, we don't have it?
Just read it as it's written on the yes.
Thank you. I move that the council adopt the January schedule of bills as presented, and that the office be authorized to issue checks and make payment on those bills.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion on the schedule of bills?
A little orientation for council. If you've read it, schedule of bills for January 12th to February 8th, that's expenditures that are a little bit higher than the monthly average, and I dug through them, and this is roughly the major elements. A lot of them are capital expenditures that we voted on at prior meetings, but just to call them out for you, there's about $14,000 on the T2 software, that's the parking automation software and digital ticketing system, that was, contract was signed last year, but the bill came in after the new year. There's our 73% share of the commitment to the fire company radios, for which that's one where we're borrowing an interest-free loan from the county. We did incur some overtime, presumably for snow removal, Sean, which bumps our salary expense up a little bit. And then we did finally, it looks like, get invoiced for the Rockland Avenue Bridge removal after being real quiet about it for a very long time. They finally sent us the bill. There was one I did have a question about, Sean, and that's VSBA for design services, construction documents. That's Venturi Scott Brown. That is the bridge design. Okay. Sometimes the abbreviations throw me for a loop. Other than that, those are kind of the unusual, other than insurance premiums, which we kind of know happen when they happen annually. Those are the unusual ones.
All right. All in favor of approving the bills?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? None. Unanimous. Are there any other motions this evening? Hearing none.
Not much.
One can always put a motion on the table.
You always put a motion on the table. Table it later. So just so we can have a discussion, I'm going to remove it. I'll move to, I'll make a motion to consider an override of the mayor's veto of ordinance 94.
But your motion would be to override the mayor's.
Motion, yeah, sure. Yes. Motion to override the mayor's veto of ordinance 94.
Is there a second?
No, a second.
Okay, so okay, now we can have a discussion. Thank you.
Any comments?
First of all, I want to really thank and make sure that people understand how important our planning commission members are, all seven of them. They've done a lot on this, and I know they're pretty miffed by what's going on. But personally, and I think every member of this community should have great respect for their effort, for their thoughtfulness, because they are being extremely thoughtful. What their goals are, from what I perceive, are not different than the rest of the population in the room. I think they truly want a effort that, yes, saves the church, but yes, doesn't harm people in their ability to park or have an inordinate amount of traffic on the block. So I think we all need to respect that and appreciate that. One of the things Mr. Gordon brought up was which neighbors would the parking affect if this was to occur? One of the other lines that somebody else put was fair and reasonable. My issue has been all along understanding what we could do in the conditional use area to make sure that that impact, if we were to allow a office use in a similar manner that Mr. Gordon has described, how can we do that and really ensure it doesn't impact any specific neighbors, it's spread out throughout the borough, it's controlled with how many potential cars we would have. I don't feel personally, based on the comments I've heard from our solicitor, from other people, that the word reasonable protects us, and when I say protects us, protects the concern of parking and traffic, and others disagree with me. And that's the area that one thing that Bob, myself, I think almost everybody in council also would look at is we need to find a long-term parking solution. The 200 block Marion Avenue came to us, and I believe not tonight. Tonight we'll be putting it forward to introduce the ordinance to give them a two-hour zone. And as soon as that happens, I wouldn't be surprised to hear the 100 block and the 300 block where I live on come in. And at some point in the not too distant future, with or without this building, we're going to have zero places for anybody that works in the borough to park. I'm not comfortable passing an ordinance that says we can have that a business with 10, 20, 30, 40 employees, whatever the number is, can come in, take care of a building, invest however much money, and then 2 months or 2 years later, find out that, knowing that we've discussed this, but still technically realize there is absolutely no place for a borough employee to park in this borough. I don't want us to be in a position that comes back to bite us. I think there's a plan out there if we use a professional parking consultant, and we've talked about this both in my committee, the Public Works Committee, and in the Building and Zoning Committee that Bob leads. And I think we, we all can see what that looks like, give or take some details, but it's not in place now. I have to say, Mr. Fromholtz, who was hired by Mr. Gordon and has been adding a lot of input to this, is an extremely good attorney. And I watched him at the Zoning Hearing Board, which unfortunately nobody else attended, but he made a very strong case to the opposite for a different applicant on a different property that basically said having the ability to park in front of your house is extremely important. And it was a little bit, the point is he made a very good argument on behalf of this person, and he also made a very good argument that all the other houses on that block, well, not all, but many of them,
had driveways in the front that didn't lead to rear yard or garage parking. And something that we thought was resolved in the 1979 ordinance update, we don't know how the zoning hearing board's going to come out of this, but they didn't come out of this, as I would have expected, in 5 minutes and say no. They want to look at it further for whatever reason, because he made a very convincing argument. And I don't want to see us go ahead, move this to a conditional use level, and then have that come back and bite us. Just the same, I don't want to see us say, go ahead, knock it down. Don't threaten us, don't do this, because it doesn't do anybody any good. You've got a building there that somebody is willing to invest the money in, and I would love to see it residential preferably. I think it's less impact. I don't own the building. And I'm not the next door to the building because I don't have that wherewithal to do that. I don't think anybody in this room does, or they would have approached Mr. Gordon and made him a reasonable offer at some level. And maybe the brand has, but it's still not happening, and you can't say that. I think, I would like to give this another week and a half, so that our solicitor and maybe can come up with a way that if we do allow this to go to conditional use, we have no risk. That's my fear, is conditional use has that word reasonable in it. And Mr. Walker, if I'm not mistaken, he pointed out that it's not reasonable if we allow an office use to then go back to another office, which you do, and say, you have to have a head. I think the problem's gonna be is we really need to put a parking plan in place. And that's going to take anywhere on the short side of 3 months, on the long side of 6 or 7 months. And I don't know if he has the patience or not. That's something that the owner of the property will have to decide. But I'm committed because of this, because of form zoning, because it's a reality that we keep having this parking issue. And on the other side of the point, I walk through South Narberth during the day, and there's dozens and dozens of parking spots that somebody who might have commuted into the city could have taken if we knew that they would actually leave at a reasonable hour and that we can enforce that. And I think we can come up with that program. I would be willing, and I would ask my council members, I don't know if we can do it at this meeting or we have to, is to commit to spending the money on a professional parking firm that does these type of plans. It does a few things. It inventories, it studies, it implements, and the most important thing, which Mr. Metrick has pointed out, it gives us a way to maintain that going forward when a block changes and I have kids with three cars or a house gets subdivided or whatever it is, it maintains the flexibility and teaches us how to control that going forward. Now, a developer might not like that because he might have to ask his employees to park up on Windale in front of Mr. Cornwell's house, which I'm sure he would be fine with. He might have
space on Windale.
He might have to ask them to park in Narberth Park, wherever Cindy is, which is a private street, so that might be a little trickier. But he might have to, do what our kids do and walk a certain distance. The employees might, this program might come out that we find that it's not as acceptable as I think it might be. But I don't want to give up. We have to have this done one way or the other, because if we're going to get to form zoning in the next couple months, the same exact issue is going to come up, except not as glistening to one particular property. And I would like to get that resolved, because most of form zoning is going to be a very helpful going forward to this town. There's a couple items I have that are my personal bugaboos, but I don't think people understand the parking in form zoning. And there are some issues there that once people get that same last minute chance to realize, ooh, this could happen, they're gonna come out just like you're at tonight, and I don't wanna see that happen either. So I guess what I'm gonna put forward in conversation, and then if we need to formalize it anyway, we'll figure that out with the help of Mr. Walco, is to delay for a week to 10 days, we can come up with a date where we reconvene, we would not close this meeting. And if we can come up with a way that we can explore this, risk no threat of repercussions. And I don't want to do it on the spot. I don't think that's a good way to make policy, but I do think the effort, given our professional help, could be there. And it may be a case of this amendment does get vetoed and comes back in 2 months in extremely similar language, or 4 months it might be, but with the knowledge of this is the parking plan that would be working in conjunction, not with just this property on South Narberth, but the other properties that the mayor mentioned. And I think that would cover a lot of basis, because I do concern myself for those other properties. We do not know, you know, what the value of a church building with office use potential could possibly be. And, you know, the Catholic Church keeps closing different churches. I think, you know, St. Margaret's probably is in great shape. It's in a good location, and, you know, but you see the consolidation that, again, is out of our control. I don't know the Lutheran Church. The other churches, they're just as viable for this in a year, 3 years. And it may be a good thing to do, it may not be. I mean, you know, office space doesn't excite me, even though that's my wife's world. But so I would ask us to do the following. Delay closing this meeting so that we can discuss this further, where we delay this. And second, at this point, discuss if there's a will of council to put forward the effort in a short-term, not short-term effort, but to move quickly to locate the right parking planner and expend the funds that it would take, which I would ballpark at $25,000. Based on, we have interviewed a couple parking planners already, and I won't say that they're definitely the best fit, but they are quality, you know, they're quality groups, and that price range has been what I've been hearing. It may end up being $50,000, maybe $10,000. You know, ideally, if we had the right time, we could use some of our own resources. I don't think we have the right time if we want to get through form zoning. We want to decide if this, you know, if this is a viable project or not. So I'm going to shut up for now and see if others on council have thoughts on that.
Can I ask a question? Are you suggesting that we just do this, to begin the study in South Narberth to address this immediately, or are you suggesting that we take the whole project on at this point?
The whole project. You have to, because you get back to that, both spot zoning and also, I think some of these spots would want to be distributed if we needed to do that. I don't know.
I just wanted to be clear, because we had discussed the pilot thing at one of the meetings, right? So that's all I'm trying to clear up.
Yeah. Can I just ask the solicitor quickly, Mr. Walco, what would be the mechanism for us to override this veto, and if for council, if they wanted to vote to override, and if they weren't inclined to do it this evening, how would they be able to extend that?
You would have to continue, you would have to table the discussion at the end of the discussion, and then continue that discussion at a further meeting. Now, in the meantime, the hearing itself is closed, and there really should not be any new evidence that could be put into the record to be considered. Now, that's not to say that you can't do your own investigations about the ordinance in general, but if there's an idea that we will do a parking study, we'll come back and we'll use those results to determine whether or not we should approve this ordinance. I think that would be improper. But again, this, as I recall, one of the amendments that we made to this ordinance was based upon the idea that a parking study would be done borough-wide. I'm not sure when that was made, and that's when we at subsection G, where we talked about the borough council may designate on-street parking permit locations for such persons that are different than the parking zones in the immediate vicinity of the subject property as part of the conditional use approval. I think the idea was that a parking study was going to be done, we wouldn't have borough-wide knowledge as to where there are parking spaces available that any conditional use applicants under this this ordinance could be placed, not just on the south side, but worldwide. So I think this ordinance sets up the idea of having a parking study. I would be hesitant to say that council should keep this open indefinitely. The way that the borough code is set up is that the mayor only had sort of a limited amount of time until his last meeting to enter his veto. If there's going to be ongoing discussions, ongoing issues brought up, you're getting in the realm of having separate public hearings, separate public meetings. And quite honestly, the record should be closed, and anything that this council should know and should consider should already be on the record for purposes of the hearing.
Okay. Thank you. And Mr. Wigger, just if I could understand.
Well, that said, I guess I would, you know, I wouldn't see myself voting to overturn this tonight. And I wouldn't see myself voting to overturn this without a known parking plan, not just that there is going to be one, but a known one. So,
by known, you mean that we would do one, not the results necessarily.
No, this is the results in the plan. Okay. If 30 employees were to come to this borough in this location or this location, this is what, as of today, where we would, give those spots to permits. And we would have a second class of permits, things of that nature.
Because really where the parking study would be useful would be if this ordinance was to pass and there was an application at that conditional use hearing for that applicant, they would have to establish their burden to show that they meet the ordinance. They would have to show that they have adequate parking for their site. If they're able to establish that, they meet the ordinance. It is then up to a protestant or council to come up with their own studies to show why that may not be true or why they have different opinions. So if that was the case, it would be beneficial to have a parking study at the conditional use hearing to ensure the accuracy of the developer's studies.
So that still doesn't address my question.
To take it further, if then there is a study by council, there is a study by an independent study presented by a protestant, study by the developer, it's up to council to determine what they believe and give credit to the study they would like to give it to. I think that's when we get into the idea of what is reasonable. Mm-hmm. There has to be a basis on the record for council to make those conclusions and not just conjecture or suspicions or guesses as to what's going to happen. But again, that would be at the conditional use hearing. So I believe a parking study would be crucial to have for any conditional use application that would come forward if this ordinance was to be passed.
And John, to that point, even if it doesn't pass, if applications come for conditional use on existing properties under the existing ordinance 964, council has the ability to impose reasonable conditions on development.
That's already in place.
Already in place.
Section 12489, the non-conforming use ordinance, as it stands.
But you're saying, those reasonable conditions have to be based in some sort of empirically supported rationale.
Well, yes. This ordinance actually gives a little bit more control to council.
Exactly.
And to the Planning Commission based upon the facade easement and facade agreements that must be put in. It gives more control over the look of the building that usually would not be given. This ordinance does give, I think, council more control because of the words in the ordinance itself addressing parking and the need to have residential units all on site. So that's not conditional use, that's in the ordinance itself. On top of these protections, there are the type of conditions that may be site specific that would be.
And council, Planning Commission in their hearing can suggest and council can impose site specific conditions.
Correct, and that was done on the projects that's already done the conditional use hearings under the residential version of this. And there are facade agreements that have been filed. There are conditional use orders that are in place. And whatever the conditional use order says, it could have numerous conditions, but usually the first condition is comply with the findings of the Planning Commission. And that's what's in place right now on the ordinances, I'm sorry, on the conditional use projects that have already undergone.
Maybe I'll just summarize where we stand. We could we could table this ordinance, or table this motion, and perhaps address it at some short period of time in the future, where perhaps based on further research or change of feelings, councilors may choose to vote differently than they might tonight. We can vote. If we were to override the mayor's veto, the ordinance will, the ordinance amendment will pass, ordinance 94 will pass. If we don't, then it's finished. Is that right? There's no more back and forth.
Correct.
It could be reintroduced, however.
As with any other ordinance, it would just go through the normal process of going through the planning commissions, being advertised, and other hearing.
Let's go around and go ahead. You have
so I just have several questions for the solicitor, actually. When, under ordinance 984, when does a developer or property owner submit plans for a project?
The plans, it would have to be a site plan as provided along with the application. So you would submit a conditional use application, and I believe the borough has recently retooled to beef up the requirements discussing the project, but then the site plan is submitted specifically, citing to this ordinance as to why you're applying if it was to pass. That site plan is then provided to the Planning Commission. The application goes to the Planning Commission to look at the site, and it can go back and forward between the applicant and the Planning Commission for some time until the applicant and the Planning Commission feel comfortable moving the plan along to council. At that time, hopefully, the Planning Commission would have made its recommendations to say, we will approve of this site plan as long as all of these conditions are met. Usually by that time, the applicant will also be in agreement with the Planning Commission. It then comes to council for the conditional use hearing. Council, at that conditional use hearing is the time when all of the neighbors in that area would receive notice, because it is then site specific. Can look at the recommendations, can add their own conditions. And at that conditional use hearing, it's up to the developer to prove that they meet the conditions that are established under the Narberth conditional use ordinance and the conditions that are set forward in this ordinance. And if there are any conditions that council feels need to be met in order to benefit the public, the welfare, the safety, the overall environment, those can be imposed as well. I believe Mr. Gordon mentioned 6 conditions that he said that he would agree to at that time. And at that time, that's when he would need to agree to those conditions, and we could hold him to that and make those part of the conditions under the conditional use order. 2 of those conditions of the 6, quite honestly, he's going to have to agree to anyways. The preserving the exterior of the building and the disbursement of parking, those are required under the ordinance. But the backlit signs, the 11-car parking, the office time is open, and employee caps, those are conditions that could be agreed upon at that hearing. Or if council has a reason to believe that employee cap is necessary, council can impose an employee cap. The question then goes into the issue of, well, what would be a reasonable cap? Council would have to have a reason why they think more than 30 employees would be harmful to the public. If that can be established, we can impose that condition. He can always challenge that. But if we're able to establish why we believe that is a reasonable number, we would be successful.
If there were a cap that were satisfactory to members of council and he were to volunteer that cap at this time, could that be included within the conditional use?
So that would be a matter for the conditional use. Again, council, to take a step back.
Has he volunteered several items?
Yes.
That were concurrent with council, the items the mayor asked on behalf of the South Side.
Clearly council, and everyone knows that if this ordinance was to pass, it appears that Mr. Gordon would be putting in an application for conditional use approval for his project. Council and Planning Commission will be able to look at that project. We can't pretend that that's not going to happen. It wouldn't be prudent to do that. At this time, this ordinance should not be thought of simply for that project. It then, if council was going to say, well, I'm only going to agree to this ordinance if Mr. Gordon promises six things, it then becomes, in my opinion, spot zoning. Because a special subsection of the spot zoning is contract zoning. And when it's contract zoning, any agreements that would be made would be unenforceable. And that's because a single person making an agreement that would otherwise be perfectly valid with council cannot overcome the public good and what the public wants. So Pennsylvania law has held that contract zoning is invalid for those reasons. It becomes a form of spot zoning. So any decisions that should be made tonight should not be based upon certain conditions that a developer would agree to. Now, that being said, if you know that he would make those agreements at a conditional use hearing, clearly that would be beneficial to council, that he would agree to those, and therefore we don't have to have the challenges. Now, then the issue is, well, how can we make sure that he lives up to his word? Because we can't sign an agreement that would be enforceable because of the spot zoning issues. The only issue that we would then face at that time is if he were to agree to certain conditions and pull back on those issues is that credibility is also an issue at conditional use hearings, the credibility of the witnesses and the projects, and that would be something that council would be able to take into consideration. So that is something that would be, I think, the hammer if there's someone wants to go back on their work.
And during the conditional use process, are members of the public welcomed into these discussions, these negotiations?
It's required. Generally, the discussions that we've had over this ordinance should not have been about a particular site. And clearly they have. And it's important that we, because again, the reality is we know that that application is coming. But at the time, if it was to pass and a site-specific project is presented, again, that is when, again, a public notice would be sent out regarding the conditional use hearing. They can attend planning commission meetings. There will be notices given to people, I think, within a 500-foot radius of that site, particular site. And they would also, council would be able to come in, and they should come in to present testimony at those hearings that council can rely on in making their decisions or setting conditions as to whether or not there is harm to the surrounding community. And more importantly, what can be done to lessen that harm or to get rid of those harms. That's what the conditions generally are for. So yes, the public will have plenty of opportunity. It's probably going to sound much like what we've already heard, but it would be site specific. But the only difference would be at that time, there would be a plan that would be presented, be voted on, people could see it, they could comment on it, and we would have planning commission notes and reviews based upon a site specific.
Some of us were here when the Methodist Church conditional use was approved and the Gleason Center conditional use was approved. And at that time, the applicant submitted a package of documentation specifying how they were going to architecturally treat the exterior of the building, how the windows would be organized, how the landscaping would be dealt with, including each and every tree that would be planted, each shrub that would be planted, the distribution of parking. At that time, the council asked for cut sheet submittals on lighting, on windows, on roofing, on how the mortar would be detailed, and our council actually approved that conditional use application at that time, and could have asked the applicant to change any one of those elements, but we approved that based on the Planning Commission's thorough review that took place in with the Gleason Center. It was 5 meetings. With the Methodist Church, it took place over almost a year's time. I also wanted to comment to council members and to the public that it was the Methodist congregation, it was the Methodist church that actually participated in the genesis of the Ordinance 984. 964. They, just as it frequently happens that an ordinance is created by property, you know, is held, is created in the interest of a possibility of a, of a of a significant adaptive reuse or saving of property. Just as the St. Margaret's, members of the St. Margaret's board participated significantly in the conditional use process for the adaptive reuse of the Gleason Center. And that was, that's quite an ordinary practice, to have interested parties come to the room and participate in conditioning of a project. And thank you for your answer.
And additionally, after the conditional use, if it's granted, there's still a land development process that would have to be gone through if there is land development.
Which is the belts and suspenders, the belts because and suspenders, they have to...
Rainwater and engineering reviews of the site.
But the borough engineer then will have to review the...
Right. The borough engineer is not looking at the condition, they're looking at the facade, but the actual geotechnological issues.
Any other councilors who have not yet commented before I change the floor?
So my general comment on this, and I think it's something that Katie Skeen might have brought up in her public comments, is the regarding the form-based code is something that would make, what would make for a good conditional use ordinance generally, if the goal is to preserve important historical or community fabric structures. One is that it maximizes the range of potential proposals that someone could bring on a site for consideration, so that people can be creative with what they're going to do with the building and maximize the chances that someone's going to come with an economically viable plan for keeping the building standing. So one is how open is it? Two is how well does it facilitate planning commission and council, you know, constraining that recommendation and putting appropriate conditions on any plan that's presented. And I think, per Katie's comment, that, you know, there is a conditional use baked into the form-based code. I don't, it's very thoughtfully done. It's actually broader on the front end in terms of permitted uses for a plan that someone could present than either 964 or as amended, as 984 were amended. And one advantage of 984 over what's currently in the code is, to our solicitor's point, it does add some teeth to council's ability to put conditions on the property. So, you know, in my view, the proposed amendment is a step in the right direction on both fronts, right? It opens up the possibility of people bringing more diverse plans for these structures, some of which actually have mixed uses in them now while they're still viable as a church or with a daycare center in the basement, that, you know, or beyond what our current conditional use ordinance would permit if that structure was defunct and someone wanted to come with a conditional use. But it also puts a, you know, gives us a little more teeth in being able to put conditions on a plan. What I would say is because it was, you know, we've done it fairly quickly compared to the form-based code and its conditional use provisions, which have been developed over a long period of time with charrettes and a lot of public input. People are probably better informed about the overall form-based code than they are about this particular ordinance amendment, because just at the time and the the length of time and the number of public meetings have been had for the bigger form-based code. So, you know, when we voted on the ordinance on 984 in the first place, I supported it, one, because I think it's a step in the right direction. I think it's not a step far enough on the front end of opening up, you know, potential plan submittals of a lot of different potential uses. I think the form-based code actually does it better. It's also a step in the right direction, maybe again not far enough, in tightening up the ability of council and planning commission to impose conditions on plans once they're submitted. And you know, I'd rather make progress in the right direction than not. The mayor is well within his rights to veto the ordinance, and so we're here considering whether to override it, whether we do or not. You know, I for one would rather make progress in the right direction. If we don't override the veto, we still have the conditional use provisions baked into the form base code, and if this doesn't pass, I suggest we turn our attention to that. And while I think the front end use restrictions are maybe even better, in my opinion, in what's in the form base code, it would be worth our attention in any event, because that's going to supersede whenever a form base code passes, supersede whatever we do here. Pay very close attention to the opportunities it affords the Planning Commission and the Council to impose conditions on projects once they're submitted. And just to be real clear, I think the right time for there to be discussion and negotiation with the developer and public comment on a particular plan is once a plan has actually been submitted and people can have a concrete commentary on that plan. That's not the case here because a plan has not been submitted on the property that's been discussed a lot. There's no plan that's been submitted on it because the developer would like to submit a plan that's not in conformance with the current ordinance. And the variance process doesn't have this mechanism for, you know, advancing a plan through the Planning Commission and subject to conditionality from council. So in general, I would like to see more openness on the front end of the process. I think this ordinance is a step in the right direction, but I think we have a bigger and longer term opportunity to do it right in the form-based code. I think we have that kind of sitting out there. I think it's in pretty good shape, but I think whatever happens here, we should use our learnings on this ordinance to inform what we do with that.
Okay. Not seeing a lot of other interested council members.
I have a question.
You do?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I saw your hands up. One of my questions is, if we were to engage, say, writer RFP for a parking study, as Bob suggests, whether we would have the results of that parking study back in time for the Planning Commission to make a recommendation on parking for, say, for an applicant at Elmwood Avenue. Let's say we're Pat override the veto tonight. There's going to be a time, it's going to take that applicant some time to put together a proposal, and at that point the Planning Commission could review and recommend a certain parking plan in partnership with the parking study and the parking planner. I just wonder how whether or not the timing could work in your point of view.
Well, I have to say, after what Mr. Walker said, my feeling is it was adjusted to support the mayor's veto, make a commitment to do a parking plan and study, regardless if he knocks it down or doesn't. Hope that's enough of a strong good faith on our part that would instill his interest in not knocking down and selling the building. But until we have a solid parking plan in place, I'm uncomfortable with this ordinance for the two reasons of what does this look like to the community and neighbors, and what does this look like to the full borough with the other sites that otherwise this is, you know, spot to. I think this can be done, and I'm willing to commit the dollars and energy. I think the outcome will be probably a pretty nice outcome where we can see that it should be very low impact. But until that's done, I think it would be remiss on my part to change my mind about holding off on this ordinance. Again, I would like to see this building remain, and if it's an office use, it doesn't impact us all in much of a way like it's being said, so be it. You know, that doesn't bother me. But until we have that evidence, I can't move forward on this. So I was hoping there was a way in between. I think John and Mr. Walpo stated very clearly what our parameters are. And I want to keep with that because things need to be worked out and new evidence does need to come into play and be reopening this.
If you're saying that you wouldn't be able to move forward on this unless you were able to use the results of a parking study to dictate your decision, then that
The results of the parking study could dictate whether or not we provide a conditional use approval.
Do you agree with that?
I agree with that.
So we do have that authority.
And Bob, I think that to answer your question, I'm not sure how long it takes to do a parking study. Mm-hmm. My experience is, depends on how thorough you want the study to be as far as how many days to go out.
It's not just a study, it's a plan.
Borough-wide, if that's what you entail to do. And we would have no direct control as to when an application would be filed.
Sure.
As well. There are certain times that actions have to be taken once the commissioner's application is filed. Obviously, council could work with the developer to try to time something to their advantage, because it's to the developer's advantage from the applicant work that I do to make sure that the planning commission has everything they need to give them the recommendation. So I think it would come up to when the application would be filed and the extent of the parking study that you want to have done.
Anyone who hasn't had a chance to speak? I'm watching the clock. We still have some additional business to discuss this evening.
Sure. I mean, I'll keep it tight. Maybe one way to keep it tight is I'm not going to change my stance from how I voted previously. I'm not going to switch to a yes and vote to overturn the mayor's veto. But I do want to echo some things that were said. I think Bob commending the Planning Commission is on point. Although I think they will disagree, certainly with Bob and I staying as no, I do think the level of effort that they put in is tremendous. It's been tremendous since I've been on council, preceding council. We have seven great people who we've appointed to that commission. And although I'm staying with the no, I don't do that as a disservice to the work that you do. Charlie, I think you hit the nail on the head. I see turning our attention to the form-based code with a parking study as a better way of dealing with this process. Hopefully, Mr. Gordon, who I'd also commend for buying the building, having a vision, although we're not getting there through the amendment to 964 via 984, hopefully maybe he can buy us some more time, see how the form-based code and the parking study develops. If he has to raise the building to get his money out of it, you know, that's commendable too. I don't see that as a red herring, like someone mentioned. I do see that as a very real possibility. And it would be unfortunate, but for some of the points that Bob touched upon, the parking, the level of community output, I don't think that amending our current conditional use is right at this time. I think we have other avenues that could get us eventually to the same place. And therefore, I'm going to not vote to override the mayor's veto, but would certainly support the parking study and the commitment of money to that, and turning our attention to the form-based code in the next few months, and then seeing where that leads us.
I want to say that I echo what Mr. Diaz has said about the Planning Commission, and also Mr. Wegbright. I applaud their effort over all these years. I respect the work that they do, and their expertise, and their dedication to this community, and I would like to see us focus on the traffic study, I mean the parking study and the form-based zoning, and get the language into the form-based zoning that's good in this particular part of it. So that's where I would focus. I would not change.
I will say that I will not change my vote either, so I would of course vote to overturn. I think that we're going to lose this building. That's the reality we're agreeing to in this moment. And if that's what everyone wants, then so be it. It'll go, and that's okay. We don't have another option. And so we will turn our attention to the form-based code, but we will also lose this building.
Okay. Our options before us, someone could call the question. We could take a vote, we could ask for a vote. Or someone could move to table. If we felt like a delay, the meeting date would be beneficial.
I'm going to discuss my, I'm thinking of withdrawing my second motion. Okay, so then I would motion that we table this discussion.
Okay.
Is there? And continue this meeting in the near future.
Continue this discussing this motion in the near future. Is there a second to Bob's motion to table?
I'll second.
Discussion.
Yes, and then we get to discuss.
Right. So
our move to table.
I'm trying to.
But let's keep it brief.
I thought if we table it though,
during this meeting, we can't take additional information into consideration in any future vote on the ordinance. So what's the what's the rationale for tabling to a later meeting?
No, well, that's actually serious that one of us might change their mind.
Oh, that someone might change their mind with no further information.
I think that's where we are.
That's where we are.
And I will.
That makes sense, actually.
You know what?
Maybe just let the building live another day.
I didn't comment with before we go to the table. I would say I would not change my vote either. I believe, and I hope everyone interprets this the right way, that this is the least worst solution for a building that has been unfortunately vacant for 12 plus years. And we don't get to choose the time, we don't get to choose the way. It is a choice of whether we want the physical structure to remain. I personally would love to see that. And that's why I voted the way that I did. And we don't always have the luxury of having all the information at the table. There's always some risk, there's always some unknowns. It's never perfect. That's the hard part about sitting up here. So, my two cents on that, throw that in the table discussion. And who wants to say something about table?
I don't. Unfortunately, I came into this hoping that we'd be able to do something during a table period based on our solicited information. I can't see myself having any, you know, I'm not going to change my mind unless I see, you know, a completed parking plan. Talked to a lot of people for a lot of hours over the last couple weeks, and I don't want to cut that off. I'd rather get right on to the movement of getting a parking plan going, and when we get to new business, I'll just roughly bring that up again to see if there is a desire to commit to that. But I don't know if tabling this adds anything except delaying another week or week and a half. It seems that those who are doesn't seem like it's going to change the outcomes in the short term.
Anyone else discussing the motion to table? Speak now, or I'll call the vote. All right, all in favor of tabling the motion to override the mayor's veto of Ordinance 984, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Nay.
That's six information items.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Manager, do you have a report?
I do, thank you. I'd like to thank the members of the Narberth Borough Department of Public Works, the Narberth Police Department, and Fire Department for their work during the historic blizzard of 2016, hopefully our last. Crews and I remained in communication throughout the event and adjusted their plans and expectations according to the changing conditions. I thank them for the long hours, attention to detail, and their ability to know which tasks needed to be handled and at what time. It was impressive to me that so much work got done in such a little amount of time by such a small staff. I'd like to also thank the members of our community who moved their vehicles from snow routes and then undertook the arduous task of digging out from 20 inches of snow. Testament to everyone's effort was the fact that a record low number of parking violations were issued for snow zone infractions. While much of the work was done in a timely manner, we recognize that all processes need to embrace a culture of continuous improvement. I've discussed with our crew how the event could have been handled better, the short amount of time it takes to restore the borough's public spaces to basic function. We really appreciate everyone's feedback given in the spirit of cooperation and improvement. I'd like to highlight three initiatives that will be coming to light in the next few weeks from the borough office. We will add to our current website maintenance agreement a migration to a new content management platform to allow the office more flexibility to post information and organize the way the public interacts with borough business. The office and the manager will publish an RFP for data infrastructure improvements that will encompass a basic network audit and plan and an updated VOIP phone system for the office. And the office and the manager will also publish an RFP for financial consulting services, encompassing best management practices for budgeting, accounting, debt management, financial reporting, and internal controls. And so lastly, I'd like to report that our new Director of Civic Technology, Matt West, has plunged into the deep end of our day-to-day operations and is performing admirably. His advice, professional connections, and skills in the world of IT, GIS, and municipal management are already bearing fruit for Narberth. I'd like to also recognize Leslie Marshall for her consistent effort and knowledge during a time of so much internal change. She's been able to carry on and take responsibility for the many details that go into running the organization and is a constant source of training and assistance for our staff. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions?
I just wanted to commend you, Sean. I mean, I saw what we did in prevention of people parking on the street, on the snow side of the snow room on the side of the street. And you put out the word, I think you had flyers put up, with notes put on people's cars, and it worked. So thank you. Good job.
Mr. Solicitor, do you have a report?
Just two matters to make the borough aware of. One, I've met with borough staff and a member of the Yerkes regarding two property maintenance issues, regarding two properties that are more significant. I think those issues are ongoing. We had some fruitful discussions and we're taking some direction to correct some serious property maintenance issues. The second—
These are with private properties?
With private properties in the borough. The second is what Mr. Weibrecht testified to previously regarding the zoning hearing board I attended. The zoning hearing board has not rendered a decision. This is really regarding the interpretation of what is a driveway versus what is a parking space. They're going to be rendering their decision without any testimony. The hearing is closed, so I don't believe there's a reason for me to go back and confirm that today with the zoning hearing board solicitor. I believe it was the right thing to oppose. I believe our interpretation is correct. And we need to enforce our zoning officer / manager's opinions and interpretations. Regardless of how the zoning hearing board rules, I'm sure it will be short-lived because the form zoning code will be passed. And I've discussed with Mr. Metrick additional changes that may need to be made to the form zoning code to clear up this definition moving forward. So hopefully, regardless of the outcome, it will be a non-issue when that code is passed. So those are the two appearances that I've made for the borough since our last meeting.
Thank you. Any specific questions for the solicitor? I have the reports of the library, the fire chief, building permits, police chief, treasurer's report, and the tax collector's report, which will be filed and made available for the public. Start looking. Tom, do you have a police report?
I do. It's in my office. I'll send it to
you. I just promised everybody that it's in this folder.
Public works, no.
Yeah, not this one.
Tom, you'll stick it in the yellow folder tomorrow. All right, thank you. We have for discussion release options for the new Verizon Senior Center. Mr. Diaz, you had pushed this to this meeting.
Yeah, and I was actually going to recommend that we push it to committee. I don't have much new to report. We have been in touch with their lead negotiator, Bill Becker. He still expresses that they are continued to fundraise based on what he views as limitations that we put on them, those being a 3 instead of a 5-year lease and the high rent that the borough is charging. His words, not mine. Mm-hmm. I think that taking it to committee, we can hear what members of the public have to say. We've invited via the borough manager, the executive director of New Horizons, to our meeting on the 18th, where we're also going to be discussing other public spaces in Narberth. I think it just gives us a better opportunity to see whether or not it will work at 21 Sabine, or if we can continue to facilitate their programs here.
Mr. Metcher.
Just to clarify for Mr. Diaz and the public, the reason that I invited New Horizons to attend the property committee meeting was to discuss and participate in the committee's development of policy and procedure for the rental of borough-owned spaces and public spaces. As you know, New Horizons currently occupies borough administration building 3 days a week, and in heavier times of programming 4 days a week. So that's the topic of that discussion. I think the discussion of the lease should not be done at that meeting.
I agree. I think just to clarify, you know, as a committee, we've consistently taken the position that in the borough's role as a commercial landlord of that property in particular, We don't want any either reality or perception of any kind of political influence influencing our actions as a commercial landlord. And as such, we've outsourced the listing and lease negotiation and property management of that property to a professional manager who's, I hope still, in the case of the new property manager, acting as the point of contact for the one remaining outstanding lease negotiation.
Mr. Walco's taking it over for the one remaining from Mr. Prep. We'll be handing over to Yentis if it is not consummated with New Horizons.
Good. And as Sean said, the we're hopefully having put lease negotiations on our commercial property behind us, and if not, handing over any closeout to our professional outside manager, we can turn our attention to planning for our civic buildings, including this one, and making sure that we're planning for them and investing in them in a way that's conducive to.
It might be an alternate. The documents surrounding the Civil Service Commission were all sent to this morning. I don't expect that you would have full review of those documents by tomorrow night, but we certainly would have Mr. Henderson joining us to present the Civil Service Commission's recommendations to us, and then therefore we would, if we agree or agree, want to go back, we would take the recommendations to council.
Is the meeting still currently on until
it's
canceled?
On at this moment. I'm wondering if anyone could advise at what time frame you would recommend canceling that.
Well, does anybody attending the meeting not in walking distance to the Borough Hall?
I will not be in walking distance. I will be on my way. Unless it's a really bad storm, then I may well be here.
Well, can we move that to the following Monday at 7:30, Mr. Diaz, Ms. Richmond?
I can do 8 on the following Monday. I can't make 7:30 child care.
That's on the 15th?
No.
Yeah,
yes, the 15th. Sorry.
It is President's Day. We're not observing at my offices.
Is that a problem here, Sean?
Observed by ensuring the public safety.
Okay, so the 15th is out. I'm sorry, Mr. Metrick's not available. The office isn't available. So how about, let's go to the 16th.
Tuesday.
The 17th.
I'm out. It turns out it's Wednesday, the Thursday next week that meeting I'm going to do, so I'm shot.
Calendar session.
Yes, right.
Well, I'm just by email.
It sounds like the meeting will not go forward tomorrow night.
No. So therefore, we'll cancel, Mr. Metrick, if you would put that on the website, and we will cancel that meeting.
We'll figure out.
I will speak
I'll
to Mr. Henderson.
I'll send you some dates for February that we're
thanks
figure
so
out
much.
Our schedules, the borough calendar.
It's just a cleanup from 15 that we've got to get done.
All right. Thank you.
Mr. Wigbring.
As I started to discuss on the earlier part of the discussion, I would like council, and we'll figure out the mechanism in a moment, but start with the concept and then the mechanism. Us to undertake an RFQ, the intent of hiring a parking consultant to, as we said before, inventory, plan, maintain, implement, and enforce so that we could have a borough-wide mechanism in place to address all these parking issues that we've been talking about, but to do it now. Let's get this process started. It's going to take, ideally it'll take 4 or 5 months. The reality is it never takes what you expect it to take. And so there's two parts to it. First is the commitment to do it, and the second part is the recognition there's a commitment of money. I think it's a good investment. I don't know where we have money in the budget for that or not. I know we've been very creative about realizing where it serves us, be it part public safety, part economic development, whatever it may be, to allot this, or zoning is obviously a clear one, but we're just going to be wrestling with ourselves with this issue otherwise. So I'll leave that to the rest of the council, either Ray or Ray or comment.
We can have a discussion, or you could make a motion to
solicit an RFQ and go to the second. Because to get the request for quote is not...
It also commits, and let's be real, that, you know, we want to see if we get locked in for some reason, the owner of that building does not knock it down, which doesn't sound like it's going to be real, but either way, that would be something that might help that cause, but more important, the overall picture, so that we get it.
Well, we need a form base.
Yeah.
What you're proposing would not involve a lot of heavy resource allocation to the borough office staff.
You recognize that we don't have that accessible at this point.
Okay. Go ahead.
I would just like to suggest that the building and zoning committee work with the office to write the RFP. And we'll have that ready by the next session.
He suggested that the Building and Zoning Committee write an RFP, which would be offered at the next council session for us to, that's a suggestion. There's no motion on the table.
I'm just suggesting it to you. It's up to you.
I think we can do it sooner, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. Sure. Whatever we need to do,
let's do
it. But when we get to voting on money is really when it comes down
okay,
to.
Okay, well, let's put it together soon.
Okay.
So we'll do our best with
make a resolution.
So we resolve to build and zone committee resolve to put together an RFP as soon as possible without imposing on the borough staff as much as possible.
Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah. And,
in regards to market
in regards
borough-wide
to
the market
borough-wide set. Market set. Yes.
All right. All in favor? All right. Someone second it.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, you'll be done. Any other new business? All right, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
I'll set that.
I'll second that.
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Done. Aye.